I got a little bit from Barbara Brown Taylor for you this morning. I think this came out of my Pentecost stuff that we were doing last week in one of my services. I think we'd like life to be like a train. You get on, you pick your destination, and you get off. But it's really more like a sailboat ride. The weather changes, and the currents change, and the winds change. Life is way more like an unpredictable sailboat. We kind of sometimes want it just to be like a train ride, I think. So I'd love to hear. I don't have time because I can't take the time on it. But what that was like, an experience for you, to hear something that you didn't understand. Did you have any idea that our band leader speaks Mandarin? Did you know his story at all? He's fluent in Mandarin. And Moni, sitting beside, sings in Mandarin, too. You know, we have all sorts of hidden little gems over here. You should hear Rob's story someday. It's a most interesting story, where he grew up, the experiences he's had in his life. Because hearing something in another language can be very strange, can it? I know many of us have traveled, and what it's like to be in a different world where we can't understand everything around us, where the culture is really, really different, and how strange that can be. I want to tell you a story this morning about two young women in their early 20s, North American women, and they, young girls, and they headed off into Turkey on an adventure. They had, they were typically North American girls, long blonde hair, and driving a car, and they headed into Turkey. They'd heard about a little town in the south of Turkey that they could stay at, and so they thought they'd go and have a nice holiday time down there. And as soon as they crossed into Turkey, something began to happen to them that hadn't happened to them before. Every time they stopped for food or for gas, all the men in the villages would come and circle around their car, bang on the car, the windows were open, they'd put their hands through the car to touch them, they'd give them money. Well, the girls found this pretty annoying, as you can imagine. It wasn't very comfortable at all. They continued to make their way down to the south of Turkey and to the little village that they were going to go and stayed and settled in there. And they found again, the men were often grabbing at them, sometimes putting their hand through the window of their house with money in their hands. It was really annoying and irritating to them. One day, they decided to go to a beach a little bit away from the village that was remote and desolate. And they thought, finally, some peace and quiet, all is well. And they took off their t-shirts and sitting there in their little bathing suits enjoying the hot summer sun in the south of Turkey. When down the beach, they could see these four people coming towards them with something long in their arm, in their hand, and they were a little scared because they're in a very remote location, and they tossed their t-shirts back on and made to move away. But then they realized who was coming towards them was not a group of men that was going to pester them. It was a group of women. And so they just stayed in their place, and the women came along and took a look at them and shook their heads. Oh, no, 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 no. And then they pointed to the clothing that the women, the Turkish women, were wearing. Now, it was a hot, hot Turkish summer, and these women had a headscarf on, and they had layer upon layer of clothing, a big outer dress and an inner dress and then an outer garment under that so that their legs were all covered as well. And they kept saying to the girl, one word that the girls recognized was çok güzel. In Turkish, that means good. And that their clothing was good, and that what the girls had on their t-shirts, got out all. Well, the next morning, one of those girls decided that she would go to the market and go shopping. And in the market, she found for herself a Turkish mountain dress. It was long, from shoulder to the ground, and had embroidery on it. It was typical of what the women were wearing. She didn't buy all the layers that the women wore, but she at least covered herself in a Turkish mountain dress. Well, things began to change in the village. The women began to talk to her. The women began to walk beside her on the road. The women began to want to include her in their circle of women. And the men, they stopped reaching out to her. They stopped grabbing at her. They stopped putting their hands through the windows of her house. Things really changed. And what the young woman began to learn was what a culture was like. This was an Islamic culture that she'd arrived in. And in Turkey, women are dark-haired. The only women who have blonde hair are women who have intentionally dyed their hair blonde to let the men know that they're for sale, that they're prostitutes. She didn't know that the only women who drive cars in Turkey at that time were prostitutes. So when she and her friend entered the culture with their long blonde hair and their car, they were sending out a clear message, and the men were simply responding as they had been taught to respond. The days moved along living in the little village, and at one time, a man did something he'd never done before. The way in the village was that the women gathered the water, and so these Western girls had to take a container of water from their house to the well every time, fill it up with water, and carry it back. Very hard work for a young Western girl, not trained in carrying heavy cans of water. Extremely difficult. Men would never touch water. It was women's work. They would sit and watch the women do the water work. One day, the young woman in her mountain dress appeared at the well with her can of water and filled it up. And one of the men, instead of watching, got up from his table with his friends, came over and picked up the can of water and walked to her house and left it on the outside of her house, never once touching her, never once offering her money, but treating her with respect. He entered her culture as well as she entering his culture. We all live in cultural worlds. They can create real barriers for conversation, for connection, for relationships. Jesus, I was so grabbed in the scriptures this week because of that one little line. Instead of talking to you about God's kingdom and everything like that, I was so grabbed by this line from the scripture from Jesus. With many stories like these, Jesus presented his message to them, fitting the stories to their experience and maturity. When Jesus came here, he came, and when he talks to us, he talks to us where we're at. He uses stories because he knows stories sink into our psyche on a very deep level. And he used stories in scripture that are relevant to the people of that time. Images that spoke into their life. Like the Good Shepherd, he wouldn't call it because it was historically there in their scriptures and it was there culturally. A shepherd was there. Jesus wouldn't talk shepherd to Blake and to Wynn because you guys don't know shepherds. You don't know any shepherds, I'm sure. They never come over to your house for dinner. You know, we don't know them. He knew the culture he was in and he spoke into the culture that he was in. His whole life is God speaking into our culture and our life. We call it an incarnational gospel, that God took our human form. Why? So we'd know him. We could recognize him. We could understand him. We could experience what God is like. When we look at Jesus, when we hear the stories of his life, his healing ministry, when we hear his teaching, when we see the healing ministry and we hear his teaching, it is done so that we will comprehend the nature of God. That God is loving. That God is healing. That God is forgiving. That God is compassionate. That God cares. Knows about us and cares about us. Jesus came so that God would not be a foreign language to us, but made so that we could understand who God is and who Jesus is. And then I read Acts, you see, and Paul did exactly the same thing. Paul came into the villages and into the cities, and he got to know the culture that was there. He got to know the people, and he spoke to the people in words that would make sense to the people. It says, I could pull out the verses. It says that first Paul, when he arrives in Athens, first he's sitting in the big marketplace. He's waiting and he's watching. And then in verse 21, he goes into the synagogue. And in the synagogue, He reasons with the Jews that are there, and he talks scripture to them because they know scripture. They understand scripture. But then he goes to the marketplace, the big place where they're all gathered, and he doesn't talk scripture to them. He talks what we call general revelation. He talks about the God who had created all the heavens and the earth. This unknown God that you have, I'm going to make that unknown God real to you. Because that God created all the heavens and the earth. That God breathed life into you. And it is within that God that you live and move and have your being. And I'm going to make that God make sense to you. Paul deals with real people, with real faith in a real world. He connects with them right where they are. He varies what he says depending on who he's with. He gets their culture and speaks into them. It's beautiful. It's brilliant and beautiful. For us, if we were, let me show you this phrase. A word that we use is called contextualizing the gospel. And I'm not going to unpack all of that for you today, but I am going to post an article on our website from Christianity Today, which is a wonderful introduction to what contextualizing the gospel means. It means presenting the gospel in a culturally relevant way. It's to know the gospel and to know the culture. And that's what we find with Jesus, that's what we find with Paul, and that's what you and I are invited into. Like if we're with people and we talk Anglican talk, I mean, it's going to fly straight over their heads. They don't have a clue what the Anglican Church is about. We really live in a post-denominational world, so Anglican stuff won't. It'll be like speaking Mandarin that Rob was speaking. It just won't make any sense. And also, if we were to speak, Paul spoke scripture to the Jews because the Jews knew scripture. Most people don't know scripture. So if we speak Bible to people, sometimes the Spirit will use the scriptures because scripture's just so special. But many, many times, it'll sound like Mandarin to them. It'll sound like a foreign language. It'll sound discordant and won't make any sense because they don't know what scripture is. It'll just fly off their heads. We need to have that marketplace kind of awareness that Paul had. And be able to find out, be able to see people where they're at, and be able to speak the truth of Jesus into them. If you're going to bring the gospel to people, we have to know our people. So, Paul had this great line in here. When he's in the marketplace, it starts off, he says, I see that you are religious. He's looked around, he sees all the temples, all the shrines, he sees this unknown God, and so he can go in on there, that place. I see that you are religious. Well, I don't know about you, but I walk around Toronto and I don't see temples. You know, I don't see a lot of shrines, I don't see a lot of churches. There's a lot of other things, though, that I do see. And it's for eyes to have, to see where our people are. Like, if we went downtown Toronto today, there's that big car race going on, real noisy down in the center of the city. Or on any day after the Blue Jays play or after the Leafs play and the streets are full of people, or with the Pan Am Games coming, somebody could come in and take a look at our people and say, I see that you are a people that love your sports. You could ride the subway and see everybody with their handheld devices and phones and everything like that. And you can say, I see that you are a people that love your technology. You could go to Yorkdale or Bayview Village and take a look at the people there. And you'd say, I see that you are a people who love fashion. Go to a university. I see that you are a people who love learning. We need to know our culture and be able to open up our eyes to what's around us. That young woman obviously was me that traveled in Turkey way so many years ago, like 45 years ago. I needed to have my eyes opened up to what the Turkish culture was all about. I'm going to I have, ever since I've been here at St. John's, which is my fifth summer coming up now, I've had this, it feels to me sometimes like we live in a fortress here at St. John's, in terms of the community that's all around us. And I've often felt disconnected from the community, the neighborhood community of York Mills. I know some of you live here, some of you can even walk to church. But I've felt this separation between us here at St. John's and everybody that lives in all these big, gorgeous, wonderful houses out here within a 3 kilometer radius around us. And I've wondered about them. I've wondered why they're not here with us. I've wondered how, and I've said, like, I felt like there's a fortress around us that has stopped us. So I gave you this crossroads sign a couple of weeks ago with all sorts of things that are being discerned around here. And despite sort of having, I don't want to overload, one other idea came up, and I want to put it on one of these signs. And there's an expression like, this dog can't hunt, or this puppy can't hunt. I'd never heard the expression before. Drew and I were talking about ideas one time, and he said, oh, man, I think this puppy can hunt. And when he explained to me, like, it's something that has meat to it, has legs to it, he knows what to do without it. When this idea walked into my office, I had this sense inside me that I think this dog can hunt. I think there might be some traction on it. And what it is that I've just, she said to me, she was in the foyer, and a Chinese couple came into the foyer, and were looking for a church. They didn't speak much English at all. In fact, their English wasn't very good. But they were here looking for a church. And she brought to me the idea, she lives locally and says that many of the people around the church are of Chinese descent. So I began to ask other people who live locally, and they said yes. And I asked real estate agents, and they said yes. In fact, I was told 80% of the new houses that are being sold in our community around here are being sold to Chinese people, Orientals. So the idea was birthed that maybe a church service in Chinese, I don't know. But then the idea was birthed that we might do an ESL class, an English as a second language class here at St. John's. And I just began to wonder about that. And what I would say, not to them, but within my heart and to you, I would say something like, I see you are a foreigner in a new land. We too, here at St. John's, are foreigners. We're aliens in a different land too. We belong not to the machinery of this world, not to the production line, but to the one who created all the cosmos. Our family is scattered too, across the nations and across eternity with those who have gone before us. We can help you learn the language and the ways of this wonderful land of Canada. And we can also help you learn the ways of God's kingdom, of Christ's family. We can help you know that you belong. Even in a strange land, you belong. I just wonder if that idea of an ESL class is a way to break down the barriers, or crack open our community to St. John's. We are a warm and hospitable people. We got that. We know how to entertain strangers. We got that. ESL teachers, English as second language teachers, are available. Many of us are teachers and educators. All of us are literate. All of us are literate. It was brought to my mind, too, that one of the best ways to learn a second language is through music. We've got music that happens, too. I wonder if God might be calling us to this. If so, it would be the same criteria that we use for any of the other things up there. There needs to be a power of five that steps up and says, yes, this makes sense to me. This I'd like to see happen. There are a community of people all around us, and they struggle with English. Some of them have spouses that work and then are here stuck in the home, and they don't get out to get the opportunities to learn the language and the culture and integrate into the place. It just might be for us. We'll see. The gal that brought the idea for me, would you stand up, Sian? Thank you. There she is. She met the couple out in the foyer. Sian tells me she won't organize. She's not a leader. That's not her calling. And that's absolutely, I respect that. But what she is willing to be is a focal point to take the names of the people that would be willing to meet, to pray, to ponder this one out. It would require a power of five, like we use to discern anything. There needs to be at least five people, and one of those people would come up to take the leadership of the role. There's some organizing, connecting, promoting that would need to be done, obviously, if this is to happen. But if this is something that God has for us, if it lands in your heart with a, oh yes, I think this might be something, please find Sian and speak to her today after service, or you can be in touch with her or with me later on. And we'll see if this is something that we might do. I know when I was in Turkey, I needed people to make the culture meaningful to me. I didn't pick it up by osmosis. I picked it up by people caring enough to point out that I was dressing inappropriately and that I was asking for trouble. I needed people to teach me the ways. And as they taught me the ways, I settled and I felt a part of that community. I was there for about 5 months, and it was delightful and wonderful good memories from that time. As people come to live here in our country, perhaps we can help them. Perhaps, too, you have felt like a stranger in a strange land. Perhaps you have as well. Just as we finish, I'm going to ask Rob to join me again, and I'm going to ask the choir to take their place so that they'll be ready for the prayers when the time comes. But just maybe ponder that. Maybe at some point in your life, you felt like you've been a stranger in a strange land. And maybe this arrow is for you. Maybe not. Maybe one of the other ones is too for you. I know so clearly that Jesus spoke God into the culture. He adapted his words to fit the people around him. And I saw so clearly this week that Paul spoke Jesus into the culture too. And I think our community life is to translate what we know, the gospel we know, the Jesus we know, into words that they can understand so that they can know that they belong and are loved by God. How will they know unless we speak into their culture? How will they know unless we speak into their culture? How is the Spirit calling us today?